قال مولانا أبو عبد الله الحسين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه إني لم أخرج عشرا ولا بترا ولا مفسدا ولا ظالما وإنما خرجت لطلب الإصلاح في أمة جدي رسول الله أريد أن أعمر بالمعروف وأنهى عن المنكر وأسير في سيرة جدي رسول الله وأبي علي بن أبي طالب صدق الإمام وآمنا به نوروا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد Ahibai, understanding the philosophy and the goal behind the greatest revolution and the greatest movement to have taken place in human history, this eternal battle between Haqq and Batil that has managed to inspire millions of people towards the path of paradise. This movement of Imam al-Husayn in Karbala. For us, as we gather every year to commemorate the martyrdom of the Imam, it is important for us to have a very clear understanding of the purpose behind which the Imam was willing to be martyred and willing for his family to go through imprisonment. And you find that there are numerous texts, and Imam al-Husayn, through numerous manners, either through letters to his close ones or letters to the people of Basra, or through his sermons, in addition to the values that are encompassed within Surah Al-Fajr, you find that Allah, or the Imam alayhi salam, comes forward and outlines the different dimensions, the reason behind this movement towards Karbala. He writes in one of his letters to Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah, while the Imam was leaving from the city of Medina in the very early stages of the movement, Imam al-Husayn writes in his letter stating the reason for this movement, where he comes forward and he says, "Inni lam akhruj, I did not come out, neither out of injustice or boredom or to create mischief on earth." And within this, there is an ishara which is absolutely latif. Many times people come forward with the calls of reformation and the calls of revolution, but behind them there are evil agendas. The Imam makes this very clear. I did not come out of oppression. He says, وَإِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلَبِ الْإِصْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ I have come out, or I am coming out, in order to reform the state of affairs within the ummah of my grandfather. أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَعْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ I want to perform amra bil ma'roof and encourage the believers and the people towards goodness. وَأَنْحَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ And to create an environment which is conducive such that people refrain from sin. He goes on to say, Wa uridu an usir, and I want to walk in the path of, yani revive the seerah of my grandfather, and to revive the seerah and the path of my father, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For from this letter of Muhammad that is written to Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah, Ya Ahibai, we are very clearly able to see that one of the primary goals of the uprising of Imam al-Husayn was to revive the path of his father Amir al-Mu'mineen, which means that a grand part of Karbala was about awakening the Ummah and directing them towards the institution of Imama in general and directing them towards the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You find that Imam al-Hussein has specified this in concrete in this eternal letter to Muhammad ibn Hanafiya. Usir fi sirati abi Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, to revive this institution of Imama, which was tainted, which was corrupted, and the true possessors of Imamat, the ones who were deserving to be the true Imams, who were actually representing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, selected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had been outcast and had been sidelined from the mainstream understanding of Islam. For you find over here that the central principle of Ashura was to revive the institution of Imamat, Imama of Ahlul Bayt, and the wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen in general. And from here we are able to understand, Ya Ahibba'i, that there is a deep relationship between the institution of Ashura and the institution of Ghadir. Ghadir, which our sixth Imam says, Eidullah al-Akbar, the greatest Eid from all the Eids that have been ordained upon the nations, an Eid for which there is no like any other Eid. And on one hand you have Ashura, where Imam al-Mujtaba says, La yawm ka yawmika ya Aba Abdullah. This day of Ashura, in which there is no parallel to Ashura, comes together with this day of Ghadir, for which there is no other Eid similar to that. And it is important for us, and you see that within the Maqatil, Imam al-Hussein, within his sermons and his companions, multiple times when they came into the battlefield, they made reference to the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the institution of Imamat being a divine institution where Allah Azza wa Jal appoints the Imam. And you find on the other hand, from the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad al-La'in, a number of times they indicated and they clearly manifested their hatred for Imam al-Hussein. And in fact, they used that hatred for Amir al-Mu'mineen as a source of motivation for their own troops. On the day of Ashura, while Imam al-Hussein is in his final moments, covered in blood and wounds, lying on the plains of Karbala, none of the enemies were willing to come forward and strike the Imam. Shimr bin Dhil Jawshan al-La'in cries out to the people. How do you motivate them? They were terrified of Imam al-Hussein, despite the injuries that he had sustained and lying on the floors or on the plains of Karbala. They were terrified. Read the Ziyarat al-Nahya of our 12th Imam, how he describes the jihad of Imam al-Hussein. And perhaps if Allah gives us the opportunity, Yawm Ashura, as part of the Maqtal, inshallah, we shall highlight that. But Imam al-Hujjah says, كَأَنَّكَ عَلِيٌّ الْمُخْتَارِ, it is as if you were Ali ibn Abi Talib himself on the battlefield. They were terrified. When they were terrified, who motivated them? Shimr bin Dhil Jawshan. He rallies the troops and he says to them, O people, why do you hesitate in attacking him? Do you not remember that he is the son of the killer of the Arabs? He aroused that hatredness inside of them so they could come and attack the Imam with everything that they had. For you find that this institution of Ashura, the movement of Imam al-Hussein, a primary goal of the revolution of Imam al-Hussein was to invite people towards the seerah of Amir al-Mu'mineen and to invite people towards the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And in order for us to appreciate this and understand the seriousness of this issue and the manner in which Allah Azza wa Jal introduces the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen and describes the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen within the Quran. It shakes the core of a person who is searching for truth. Notice the verses of the Quran that are related to the event of Ghadir. And this entire lecture, the references are taken from Mawsu'at al-Ghadir, the encyclopedia of Ghadir, which is authored by Marhum Ayatollah al-Amini, book which comprises a full, all-encompassing account and narration of Eid al-Ghadir from sources of the Ammah as well as the Khassa. The entire lecture with every point that has been made has been referenced from this book for whoever would like to go back to it. Notice how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this event of Ghadir, which makes the obedience of Amir al-Mu'mineen wajib upon everyone who recites the Shahadatain, upon the declaration of the Imamah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Allah Azza wa Jal in Surah Al-Ma'idah, and this is something which is unanimous from amongst the Amma and the Khassa, Allah Azza wa Jal reveals this verse, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'amati wa radhitu lakum al-Islam deena. Today I have completed your religion. Today I have completed all my bounties and blessings upon you. Wa radhitu lakum al-Islam deena. Radhitu. Today I am pleased with this religion. Ajib. A person comes and says, Ya Rasulallah, was Allah not pleased with this religion until the day of Ghadir? Even the people were praying, the people were fasting, the people had completed Hajj, the people were reciting the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jal states in this verse of the Quran, Surah Al-Ma'idah, Wa al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa radhitu lakum al-Islam deena. With your Salat, with your Hajj, with your Saum, Allah is not pleased with an Islam that does not have the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Ya Ali. Ahibai, I fear that you think that or you perceive this to be emotional, empty rhetoric from the mimbar. Abadan la, refer back to the Quran. As we said on the first night, kalima kalima, word by word of the Quran, we need to contemplate over it. In the 10th AH, 11th AH, why is 10th AH, why is Allah saying, today I am happy with this deen? Was he not happy when the people were praying and salat was established and everything doing? No. The centrality of the concept of imama in the deen, bayn al-qawsain. We said in Surah Al-Fajr, Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutma'innah, irja'i ila rabbika radiyatan. Return back to your Lord while you are pleased with your Lord. Radiyatan mardiyya, ahsantum. Allah is pleased with you. So at the point of death, if you want Allah to be pleased with you, Allah is saying over here in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa radhitu lakum al-Islam. If you want Allah to be pleased with you at the point of death, and if you want to enter into Alam al-Barzakh without being terrified for your deeds, accept the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen.
Ya Ali.
Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. This is tadabbur fil Quran. This is how we put verses of the Quran together to understand the centrality and the importance of the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. When Imam al-Hussein, Sayyid al-Shuhada, walks towards Karbala and is ready to sacrifice his family, know that he has done this for values and principles that are azim. Bayn al-Qawsain, Subhanallah, this is the bahr This is, I had not even planned to say that this is the ocean of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You open one bracket, you close one bracket, another one opens. وَرَذِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينَ. I am pleased with your religion. Baba, if you want the title رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ, you need to have submitted to the wilaya of Amir al-Mu'mineen. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Tayyib, Rasulullah has completed the final Hajj. The verse of the Quran is revealed, Ya Ayyuhar Rasul, again in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Ya Ayyuhar Rasul, Balligh ma unzila ilayka min Rabbik. Wa in lam taf'al, fama ballaghta risalatah. Allah. The verse is revealed via Jibra'il. Ya ayyuh, ya, O Prophet, Ya ayyuhar Rasul, O Prophet, balligh, convey that which has been revealed to you. And if you do not convey this message, فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ. Tadabbur in the Quran, kalima kalima, who is speaking? Who is the khatib and who is the one who's the khatib? Who's the one who's being spoken to? Allah is telling Rasulullah, 20 years, 23 years of tabligh and juhud of nabuwah will amount to nothing if you don't convey this message. This message, the imamat and the wilayat of Amir al-Mu'mineen, which is very famously and captured in the words or in the statement of Rasulullah, Man kuntum mawla fahada aliyun mawla. Whoever's master I am, Ali is his master. This was the punchline, if you could use the word, the punchline of the entire sermon of Rasulullah. Now, tonight, I want for us, for that subhanAllah, this is an introduction by Allah, where time is racing against us. We haven't even started the bahath and the time is almost over. Ahibai, Allah commands Rasulullah and he says, balligh, convey. Search within the Quran, you will not find the word balligh mentioned in this manner ever again, except for this issue of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Convey this message. Ya message, man kuntum mawla fahada aliyun mawla. Now look, in Arabic language, the word balligh means convey. Convey the message in such a manner that your audience will understand the message without any sort of confusion or without any sort of misunderstanding. The message has to be delivered. This is the word. The message has to be delivered with full clarity in a way that they cannot even forget. This is the meaning of the word balligh. Tayyib. When Allah commands Rasulullah, convey the wilaya and the imamat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. What steps did the Prophet take? And how did he devise the methodology in which this message, Man kuntum mawla fahada aliyun mawla, the methodology in which this message will be conveyed? And in order for us to understand the importance of this message of Ghadir, we begin to analyze the manner in which the Prophet conveyed this. And you will find the style of the Prophet in conveying this central message of Deen. The Prophet never used it for any other aspect of La Usuluddin wa La Furu'uddin. The style of oratory skill and the style of delivering the sermon and the circumstances in which the sermon was delivered was exceptional from every possible angle conceivable. In fact, the Holy Prophet used principles of effective communication that are comprehensive in its entirety. Ahibai, it's about analyzing and understanding the message of Ghadir in today's terminology.
Those of you who have got some experience in media, those of you who have got some experience in the art of communication, those of you who have got some experience in the world of marketing and advertising, listen to these key words within these 5 or 6 points that we want to analyze, and you will begin to see how the prophet, in the eloquent, most eloquent manner, delivered this message using human psychology and the art of communication in a manner that has never been seen before. And you understand the pain the prophet went through to deliver this message of the wilayah of Amirul Mu'mineen. The pain that he went through denotes the importance of that message. Shufu ya ahibba'i. Number one, the timing and the place of the message. Rasulullah delivers this message of the imamat of Amirul Mu'mineen in a place known as Ghadir Khum, after the entire Muslim Ummah has left from Hajj. You know, as per the historians, and the majority of these historians have recorded it is from the Amma, they mention 120,000 people attended that Hijjatul Wida, that final Hajj. 120,000 was a grand number. Sometimes you would have entire cities whose population was 10 or 20,000 at that time. 120,000 people are performing the Hajj with Rasulullah. Rasulullah decides to deliver the message in Ghadir Khum. A person asks, or a person may ask, Ya Rasulullah, why didn't you deliver the message in Makkah? Why wouldn't you deliver the message in Arafah? Is there any better place to have delivered the message of the wilayah of Amirul Mu'mineen? Inside of Makkah, by the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best place on earth, the symbol of Tawheed is there. Rasulullah, despite knowing and despite appreciating, obviously, despite knowing the sanctity of the land of Makkah, Rasulullah didn't make the announcement of the imamat of Amirul Mu'mineen in Makkah. Why? Lest this command of the imamat of Amirul Mu'mineen becomes diluted in the many other rulings that the Prophet was delivering in regards to Manasikul Hajj. So there were so many messages that were coming out from Rasulullah towards the masses in regards of how to do tawaf, in regards of how to do sa'i between Safa and Marwa, and all the Manasikul Hajj. Within all this information, if the wilayah of Amirul Mu'mineen was also announced, the message, number one, could have been diluted. Number two, people would have said, they would have sidelined the message by saying, no, Hajj is more important than the wilayah of Amirul Mu'mineen. So Rasulullah ensured he selected a time and a place where, the key word, where the announcement of Amirul Mu'mineen would gain exclusivity. Ya Ali, exclusivity in announcing the imamat of Amirul Mu'mineen, lest it is not mixed up and diluted. You guys can, we can all attest to this, information overload. What happens? The mind naturally filters out some things, but knowing Islamic history, you have people who would purposely filter out things. Rasulullah chooses a time of where the message of Amirul Mu'mineen, the imamat of Amirul Mu'mineen, is going to be exclusive. No other agenda invited inside. This is one. Ani ahibba'i. This is my personal opinion. I feel, in addition to everything that Rasulullah did, Rasulullah purposely didn't announce the message of Ghadir in Makkah to allow people time to digest the fact of the authority of Amirul Mu'mineen. Why? Because when people would come to Makkah, and many of them were from Hijaz and from Misr and from other parts of Yemen, people who had never been to Makkah and never seen the Kaaba before,
For when they came to Mecca and they started to circumambulate around the Kaaba, 100% they must have seen those cracks that were there in the Kaaba. And while they were doing tawaf, the talk of the town became how Amirul Mu'mineen was born inside of the Kaaba. So that Hajj became a prerequisite for them to digest the imamate of Amirul Mu'mineen. Don't be surprised that he has been selected by Allah, because the other day you did tawaf around the house in which he was born. Number one, exclusivity of the message. Number two, location. You find even in real estate, and even when it comes to opening up businesses, khasatan, that are there in retail and so on and so forth, what are the three things you are told? Location, location, location. Location is key to everything. Don't think these are principles that were brought out by, you know, the corporate world just the other day. Abadan la, there are principles, deen, principles of ideology that are embedded that can be used in the dunya, but this is a topic for itself. Location, location, location. Rasulullah chooses Ghadir Khum. This Ghadir Khum, which is a central gathering point on the route for people who are returning back from Mecca after completing the Hajj. The final point, from Ghadir Khum, everybody begins to separate and disintegrate. From Ghadir Khum, those people who are going to Hijaz or continuing on to Medina will take a different route. Those who are going on to Egypt, Misr, would take a different route. Those who are going to Yemen would take a different route. This is the final point where everybody is one. Rasulullah reaches Ghadir Khum. He stops. People have gone forward. It's 120,000 people. People have gone as far forward as Juhfa. Rasulullah stops and he sends a messenger. Those people who have gone to Juhfa, call them back. Juhfa was 7 hours distance from Ghadir Khum. They were so ahead in the journey from Juhfa to Ghadir Khum, traveling on a camel, ajalakum Allah, or a donkey, at a normal average speed is calculated to be 7 hours distance. So you can imagine Rasulullah has stopped in Ghadir Khum, waiting for all those people who are at the back to catch up with him. Those who are gone ahead into Juhfa, retract, come back, retrace your steps. 7 hours, there are people waiting inside of Ghadir Khum. The Prophet made the people wait for 7 hours until those who have gone to Juhfa come back. If you look into the books of history, what is apparent is that from the 120,000, it's not a far-fetched conclusion that 80,000 people were already inside of Ghadir Khum. And the Prophet has made 80,000 people wait so that the other 40,000 can come. Double the population is over there. What would be is justice. Just convey the message to the 80 and they will convey it to the remaining 40. Abadan. Rasulullah makes them wait for 7 hours. Human psychology for this grand message that is coming. Rasulullah is creating a sense of anticipation within the hearts of the people. This is Rasulullah, Sayyidul Balagha. Look at all these tactics and these skills that he has used. Exclusivity of a message, location of the message, creating an anticipation towards the message. People from Juhfa come back. This area of Ghadir Khum was an area where water used to collect. The water used to collect in a valley. This valley, what is understood from Kitab al-Ghadir and other secondary texts, is that it was a valley. It would not be far-fetched to say it was the size of a football stadium, but valley enclaved inside. For the people were seated around the valley. Rasulullah stands in the center of the valley with Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya'ani, in addition to creating anticipation and the location and the exclusivity of the message, the Rasulullah was orally going to convey the message, but he stands and makes himself the center of attention so that you engage the people through sight and through hearing. Even in today, day and age, you find that they come in the field of education and learning, the skills of learning. They come and they tell you that many times we are better learners if we are visual learners. Children especially, most of them are better learning visually. In addition to our faculty of hearing, we absorb information and we seek knowledge through our eyes. وَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا Basira, sources of knowledge, eyesight and ears. Rasulullah not only made sure that the message reaches 120,000 people through kalam, he positioned himself inside of Ghadir Khum, in the center of the valley, so that people could see him as well as hear him. They could see Amirul Mu'mineen, not somebody comes tomorrow and says, we couldn't recognize Amirul Mu'mineen by appearance. Rasulullah eliminated any sort of hujja if it came to saying we didn't know. Ba'ad, our time is
sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Our time is racing. I have masaib to recite today, perhaps the following points inshallah tomorrow. Let me give this last point that is inside here and the rest inshallah khair. Maybe 2 points. It's weekend. It just came to my mind. Ahsantum. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I see these majalis, when inshallah you come out of the Imam Barga, or when you stand in the matam, chief, your heart is bursting with the love of Amirul Mu'mineen. This is Iman at its peak. This is what creates loyalty towards Ahlul Bayt. You don't become from amongst those in history who deserted their imams because they didn't have ma'rifah. This is that ma'rifah that adds value to your ziyarah when you go to Najaf al-Ashraf. Akhaf, a person comes and says, his majlis fada'il are, you know, we have this tendency, inshallah not over here, many places, we have this tendency to say, la, these are majalis wahwa, and we wasted our time and we didn't learn anything. Baba, the heat of Iman gives currency to the ziyarah when you go to Najaf al-Ashraf. Because when you stand in front of that Amirul Mu'mineen, you have a different level of ma'rifah. In any case, tayyib. Strategy of Rasulullah. In addition to everything that he has done, made himself the center of attraction and location and exclusivity of the message and creating the sense of anticipation, Rasulullah selects the time of the day that has extreme heat. The narrations mention that Rasulullah delivered the khutbah that was 3 hours long. It was not in the nature of Rasulullah to deliver a sermon so great. If you return back to the books of Sirah, you will find that majority of the historians are of the opinion, and from the sermons that have reached us, that the sermons of Rasulullah never exceeded more than half an hour to an hour max. Mostly they would not exceed half an hour. Rasulullah here makes an exception. The khutbah of Ghadir lasted for 3 hours. And that even in the heat, at its peak, it's the time of Zawwal. The sun is overhead. Allama al-Amini in Mawsu'atul Ghadir mentions that the heat was scorching. The sun was scorching. It was so hot that people had to remove their garment, the upper part, the abba, put it on the sand and stand on there because it was burning their feet. Ajeeb. Ya Rasulullah, wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen. Rasulullah, who is a Rasul of mercy,
we didn't send you except that you are a source of mercy. We also have in our seerah that once Rasulullah was reciting Salatul Jama'ah and a baby started, infant started crying. Rasulullah sped through the Salat and finished it as quick as possible. The people came to Rasulullah and they said, today you hasted in your Salat. Salat, Allah, your connection and your ma'raj with Allah. How could you have finished it so quickly? Rasulullah says, the baby was crying, so I knew that the mother is anxious. This is that Nabiur Rahmah. But when it came to Ghadir, the Prophet was willing for the people to suffer to the extent that not only were they getting sunburned, not only would they have fallen down from a heat stroke, if we could use this word in this day and age, their feet were burning. Why? Two quick things. Number one, Rasulullah was putting forward a culture that even this is inconvenient for you, even if it is inconvenient for you, even if you think it's going to cause a bit of body harm, if it is for the greater good of your akhirah, then endure that pain on your body. Because the greater good that you're going to achieve far surpasses the intermediate pain that you're going to feel. One. Number two. Habibi, Rasulullah chooses the peak of the heat. The weather circumstances contribute or would contribute towards ensuring that the message of Ghadir is not forgotten to a great extent by the people who are present. Ajib jiddan. Rasulullah Sayyidul Balagha. Sayyid of human psychology. I give you an example. How? Ahibai, have you noticed, if you were to just think to yourselves, how many times you have gone on vacation in your life? How many times you have gone for ziyarah? You may have gone for multiple vacations in your life. Multiple times, many, many places, locations, you must have gone to ziyarah many times. Are you able to remember with full accuracy all the details of what happened in each and every one of your holidays or in each and every one of your ziyarat? Could you? No. It's human nature. Things happen, the days pass, ayam, zaman, new experiences are created. And this is how the mind functions, that as you create more and more new memories, the older memories that you have are somehow pushed towards the back of your mind. So recalling them may not be that easy. It's a normal human phenomenon, nothing special. Sahilola, Jayid. Now imagine, from all the holidays that you have gone for, or all the ziyaras that you have gone for, and for all the other details that you could have forgotten, imagine, can you recall a trip, a holiday or a ziyara that you went to where you were struck or stuck in some terrible, horrible weather conditions? If you went for ziyara and you were stuck in a storm, where there was rainfall in its hardest, you would not forget that ziyarah until the end of your life. If you were going to go for ziyarah, for example, and you met a near-death experience, you would never forget that ziyarah until the end of your life. You can forget a million details of that trip, but you will never forget the fact that you almost died. You will never ever forget the fact that that particular trip was encompassed by phenomenal weather conditions that you just cannot forget. Subhanallah, this past Hajj, you talk to a number of Hajjaj, how was Hajj? Ya mashallah, it was raining a lot. Ajib. The Sa'i, Arafah, everything doing, the big thing was the rain. Now we're from London, so weather is a big thing anyway. But generally speaking, ahibai, weather, terrible weather conditions that either made your trip or ruined your trip is something that you will rarely forget. And the same principles used by Rasulullah, that he selected the hottest time of the day, such that when you went back in the trip and people asked you, even if you forgot anything and everything about the manasikul hajj, you would not forget the trials and the tribulations of sitting in the khutbah of Rasulullah for 3 hours under the
scorching sun. Why? Because Rasulullah was saying, Man kuntu mawla fahada aliyun mawla.
There is much to say, our time is. Last point, inshallah.
Ahibai,
bay'ah. After everything Rasulullah did, he ensured that for a period of 3 days, the people would give bay'ah, pledge allegiance to Amirul Mu'mineen before dispersing and leaving for their homes. Mawsu'atul Ghadir, you will find sources that are Shia and non-Shia that attest to this. Even if a person slept through everything, even if a person couldn't hear and couldn't see, even if a person passed out in the heat of that khutbah, he had no excuse to say that we didn't know about the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Because finally, when he would wake up or whatever happened, he couldn't leave Ghadir Khum until and unless he pledged his allegiance to Amir al-Mu'mineen. This one word from within the Quran that Allah Azza wa Jal uses, balligh, convey. Look at the pain that Rasulullah went through to deliver this message of the wilayat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Look at how everything was meticulously planned by the Prophet of Islam. And after all this, he says, فَلْيُبَلِّغْ الشَّاهِدُ مِنْكُمْ الْغَائِبُ. After everything, he says, and convey this message to those who are not present. Rasulullah, I have seen within books, ulama state that conveying the message of Ghadir is a wajib kifai. Based on the statement of Rasulullah, فَلْيُبَلِّغَ الشَّاهِدُ مِنْكُمْ الْغَائِبُ. There is grammatical implications into deducing the hukum of wajib kifai, which is found within the principles of jurisprudence. It's out of the scope of this lecture. And how did Ahlul Bayt, what extent did Ahlul Bayt go through to defend this message of Ghadir? Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra sacrificed Muhsin in defense of the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is Imam al-Husayn who has come to Karbala to revive the wilayah of Amir al-Mu'mineen that has been commanded. Poet, and I'll end with this, the poet sums something beautiful. He says, Ya Abul Hasan, how great and how divine are you that your wilaya was ordained in the heavens from the very top of the arsh on Yawmul Ghadir. Ya Abul Hasan, submission towards you was made obligatory upon all the jinn and all the malaika and all of mankind. Ya Abul Hasan, was there ever a doubt even before Ghadir that there was no wasi of the Nabi except you? Ya Abul Hasan, where were the rest of the people in the battles of Badr and Khaybar and Khandaq and Uhud? They all ran away from the battlefield out of treason. And the most courageous ones of them managed just to sit on the sidelines of the battlefield while they watched you disperse the forces of shirk and kufr as you came down upon them like a raging lion and a destructive storm. When the sand settled on the battlefield, they saw you hold the towering door of Khaybar. They cried out in, Oh Ya Ali, the malaika from the heavens in rejoice cried out, Ya Ali, and as for me, until I enter my grave, and inside of my grave, I will cry out, Ya Ali.
Ya Ali!
Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. أحبائي يوم عاشوراء. When the family of Bani Hashim, when the youth of Bani Hashim entered into the battlefield, one by one they went, single combat and in twos and threes. And each and every one of them gained martyrdom until came the time of the children of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. And tonight, truly, it's about paying tribute to Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba for his children in the way that they represented him and gave sacrifices on the day of Ashura. Do you know Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba had six children, six sons who were present in Karbala on the day of Ashura? Three of them were taken as prisoners. Two were children of the age of about 11 and 12. And one was Zayd and Amr. The third was Hassan al-Muthanna, Hassan the second. Hassan al-Muthanna was 22 years old. And he went into the battlefield and he fought courageously defending Imam al-Husayn. The Maqatil mentioned he received 18 sword and spear wounds on his body. And one of his hands were cut off in battle. And because of the pain of the injuries and the fact that one of his arms were cut, he fainted in the battlefield. They thought that he was dead. It was only on the 11th of Muharram when he gained consciousness, the tribe from his mother's side came and interceded for him, so he was not beheaded and he was taken as a prisoner. Three children of Imam al-Hassan were taken as prisoners. And three other children of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba were shaheed on the day of Ashura. The first one was Abdullah ibn al-Hassan and the second one was Ahmad ibn al-Hassan. Each and every one of Bani Hashim were courageous, without doubt, courage that has no bounds. But the children of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, Allahu Akbar in courage, Allahu Akbar in their lack of fear, Allahu Akbar in their style of attack. Do you know these three children, or these four children of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, all of them who fought on the day of Ashura? These were youth who were trained in warfare by Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Which is why when Ahmad, the second son, Ahmad, who was Shaheed, Ahmad ibn Hassan, when he came out in the battlefield, the poetry that he recited, he scared away the enemies just from his poetry. He says, "In tunkiruni fa'ana ibnu haydara, dargamun ajam, walaythun kaswara, alal a'da, mithlur rih sarsara." He says, "If you reject me, I am the son of Haydar, that attacking lion that viciously devours you, and I shall fall upon you like a black wind that swirls away everything in its way." They ran from him. Ahmad ibn Hassan, who was 16 years of age, he killed, managed to send to Jahannam wa bi'sal masir 18 generals from the major generals of the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad, until they all got together and they made him shaheed. Abdullah, the son of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, went out in three separate attacks, attacked the right wing, attacked the left wing, and attacked the center flank of Umar ibn Sa'ad. In his first attack, he killed 80 of the kuffar, in the second one 50, and in the third one 60, sending them all to Jahannam wa bi'asal masir. If we had time, we'd have explained in detail their maqtal. The narrations mention until the time of Qasim ibn al-Hassan came, when both his brothers got permission to go into the battlefield and to become shaheed. Qasim, who had just reached of age, yani just reached the age of bulugh, a youth at his peak, when he saw both his brothers have become shaheed, he approached Imam al-Husayn. And he said to him, "O my master Aba Abdullah,
will you grant me permission to become a martyr in the battlefield? Imam al-Hussein looked at him and he refused. And he said, O Qasim, you are my son. You are the remainder of my brother Hassan al-Mujtaba. You are the reminder of my brother Hassan al-Mujtaba. The Maqtal mentions that Qasim asked for permission multiple times, and each time Imam al-Hussein refused. The final time that Qasim asked for permission, when Imam al-Hussein refused, the Maqtal mentions that Shah Qasim began to cry and he fell down kissing the feet and the hands of Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Hussein did not agree. Qasim went back towards his tent. Allah, and on this night of Shah Qasim, I want to take each and every one of you to Karbala. And it is as if you are sitting in the tent of Shah Qasim. Have you seen in the Khaymaga, Shah Qasim has his own tent? It is as if you are sitting inside the tent of Shah Qasim. The narration mentions that Shah Qasim was sitting on the tent, in the tent by himself, with his hands on his knees, weeping and crying because he was not getting permission to become Shaheed. As he was crying, the Maqatil mentioned that he remembered his father had given him a ta'weed before his death and had sent to the mother Farwa or Ramla, when my son is in difficulty, make sure you give him this ta'weed such that he can open it. Shah Qasim went towards his mother Sayyida Ramla and asked for the ta'weed. The ta'weed was given to him. Shah Qasim opened the ta'weed and inside there was a letter from his father Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. It said, Ya Waladi Ya Qasim, إذا رأيت عمك الحسين في كربلا وقد أحاطت به الأعداء فبارز للقتال ولا تبخل في دمك. Imam al-Mujtaba had written, O my son Qasim, when you reach the land of Karbala and you see your uncle Hussein surrounded by enemies, then ensure that you go out into battle. Look at the last words of Imam al-Mujtaba to his son Qasim. This is the wasiyah. وَلَا تَبْخَلْ فِي دَمَكِ. He says, don't be stingy over your blood. Make sure that your blood is spilt before the blood of your uncle. When Qasim saw the letter from his father, he put it on his forehead and he kissed it. And with a smile, he went running to his uncle, Aba Abdullah. He showed him the letter. The narrations mention that when Imam al-Hussein read the letter, he began to weep. He hugged Qasim. The Maqtal mentions, Fabaka, both of them, Fabaka. Both of them cried intensely until both of them fainted. When they regained consciousness, Imam al-Hussein asked for a chest to be brought out from inside his khayma. They brought out the chest of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba that had his belongings. Imam Hussein removed the abba of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. He removed the garments of Imam al-Hassan. He placed it on to Qasim. The narration mentions then he removed the amama of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. He cut the amama into two halves and he tied it around the head of Shah Qasim. He looked at him with tears rolling down his cheeks. Imam al-Hussein said to him, Atamshi birijlika ila al-maut. He says to him, do you really want to walk towards your death? Shah Qasim replied back, and he said, وَكَيْفَ لَا أَمْشِي إِلَى مَا إِلَى الْمَوْتِ. How can I not walk towards my death? And the enemies have surrounded you. فَرُوحِي لِرُوحِكَ الْفِدَاءِ. May my soul be sacrificed for you. وَنَفْسِي لِنَفْسِكَ الْوَقَاءِ. May my body be a shield for your body. When he said this, Imam al-Hussein kissed him and sent him into the tents of the ladies to go and bid farewell for one more time. Qasim in this appearance entered inside the khaymaga. Sayyida Zainab stood up. Allah, Allah. Sayyida Zainab stood up and she looked at Shah Qasim. She said, Akhi ya Hassan. Oh my brother Hassan,
The resemblance of Qasim was such with the Amama of Imam al-Mujtaba and the Qaba of Imam al-Mujtaba. She saw Imam al-Mujtaba in Qasim, and Sayyida Zainab sat down and began to weep, hugging Qasim. My heart tells me that she only said, Ya Hasan al-Mujtaba, because when she looked at Qasim, she remembered the janazah of Imam al-Mujtaba filled with arrows being brought back into the house. Ya Zainab, the manner in which you saw the janazah of Hasan, shortly you are going to see the body of Shah Qasim. The women hugged him and all of them began to cry, bidding him farewell. The narrations mention that Shah Qasim went out of the Khaymagah. Imam al-Hussein put the armor on Qasim, and two or three times the Imam tried to fit it. But armor, ahibai, and armor is made for an adult, not for a young boy. The narrations mention that the armor was loose on the body of Qasim. He was still a young boy, a youth in his early stages. He went out in the battlefield and he began to address Umar ibn Sa'd. He said, Ya Umar, ala takhaf Allah? Do you not fear Allah? How is it that you call yourself a Muslim while the family of Rasulullah is thirsty? They cried back and they said, O Qasim, until when will you be arrogant? Why don't you come into the obedience of Yazid? Shah Qasim refused. The narrations mention that Shah Qasim went into the battlefield. The Maktal says, فَقَاتَلَهُمْ كِتَالًا شَدِيدًا. He began to attack them in a ferocious manner, dismantling their right ranks and dismantling their left ranks. All the time he was reciting poetry, إِن تُنْكِرُونِي فَأَنَا نَجْلُ الْحَسَنِ سِبْتُ النَّبِيِّ الْمُصْطَفَى وَالْمُؤْتَمَنِ هَذَا حُسَيْنٌ هَذَا حُسَيْنٌ كَالْأَسِيرِ الْمُرْتَحَنِ بَيْنَ أُنَاسٍ لَا سَكَوْ مَوْضُ الْمُذَنِ. He says, this is I am Qasim, the son of Hasan and the grandson of Rasulullah. I stand here defending Hussein, who is under siege like a prisoner. The narrations mention that Qasim performed the jihad that was Haydari, a jihad that was Hasani, sending 70 of the kuffar to Nar Jahannam wa bi'is al-masir. No one was willing to come forward. Qasim stood in the middle of the Maidan, and then he noticed that his left sandal, the lace had opened. The narrations mention Qasim bent down to tie his shoelace from the sandal, as if to say to the enemies that you mean to me less than my slipper. At that point, one of the enemies by Amr al-Azadi al-La'in, he began to run towards Qasim, and from behind the Maktal says, فَدَرَبَهُ بِسَيْفِ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ. He came from behind and he struck Shah Qasim with a sword on the head. Allah, Ya Zalim, you didn't even attack Qasim from in front. Allah, the Maktal mentions, فَفَلَكَ حَمَّتَ. He split open the skull of Qasim. The Rawi mentions mentions that Imam al-Hussein put his chest on the chest of Qasim, and he began to take the body of Qasim back into the Khaymagah. The Rawi mentions, as Imam al-Hussein was carrying Qasim, the legs were dragging on the sand. We said, how is it? Qasim was not so big that Imam couldn't carry him. The tragedy had bent the back of Imam al-Hussein. The broken bones, the broken legs of Qasim were dragging on the sand.
Mata me Hussein, mata me Qasim.